Say, man, y'all already know who it is. Pull up like money, get money. We ain't never slumming. On God.
All right, guys, what's going on? Giving you guys another view, shooting from inside the house. This time we now on the porch with it. So this segment, I'm going to call this one for you guys, why you should go legit when doing junk removal. And about why it can be beneficial for you being a business owner in the long run. So a few reasons, you want to look at it is, do you have short-term goals, long-term goals? Are you writing out like a small or five-year business plan, you know, things of that nature? You want to consider all these things. And if you are planning on growing in the junk removal business and wanting to be successful, that comes with going legit, you know, not still just doing jobs under the table, not paying your taxes, not having DOT numbers or, you know, your EIN, your tax ID numbers. Being overweighted and not knowing how to properly weigh trailers. All those things play a big factor. And are you going to be a successful junk removal business? And if you want to be successful, it all goes back to doing it the right way and going legit. You know what I'm saying? So it's just a lot of places I can start, but let's see. One, I know every state's different. Every state is different. You know, one, you might need DOT, you know, Department of Transportation. Having your DOT number in your vehicles. Just having your regular EIN or your tax ID number. Just doing business as, whatever you're doing your business as. That plays a big part in essence, too, of you being legit. Because not only does that play a big part when you go to do run your taxes off at the end of the year, but when you want to start moving up and doing things more on a larger scale, as far as, let's say you want to do commercial jobs, or you want to start bidding on, you know, things with your local agencies in your county or your government officials or whatever you might be doing, just trying to get outreach or other sources to bring in more income for your business and also for you to potentially grow. They're going to require these things, you know, being licensed and bonded. You being able to prove that, having the paperwork to submit to them via email or faxing it over, whatever it may be. So these are things you guys really need to consider if you want to really grow and become the best version of your business or whatever your intentions are. I mean, to some, the junk removal game might just be something you do just to make a little extra money on the side. And that's fine. You know, some people might opt out and they just say, hey, I'm not really trying to get too big in this. I just do this stuff for a little bit extra cash here and then. That's cool. You know, I'm not talking to you guys or females or women or whoever. I'm not talking to you people. I'm talking to people who are starting out one way, but in the overall end, you need to do everything the right way. And the right way is playing the game and going legit. That is no other way around it. I mean, if you don't want people snooping around in your business, and if you're doing everything like they say by the book and how it should be, whether your state laws are and your county laws and whatever they require for you to have, you'll do that. And you won't have to worry about nobody messing with you. So, like I say, when you guys are starting to get into heavier loads now, I mean, of course, why do you need your DOT? DOT, you know, plays a big part, especially when you're hauling and, you know, transporting heavy, you know, weight materials and things of that nature, just transporting loads, period. Anything over a 10,000 GVW, or, you know, higher, especially when you're just hauling, you know, considering the weight of your truck as well, that plays a big part. You might have a 1 ton that's gross weighted at 14K. You definitely need a DOT for that. You might have a 250 or 2,500. Gross weighted at like 10,000, maybe a little over 10,000, 11,000. That's when you start needing a DOT number. Anything with a vehicle, gross vehicle, you know, the GVW over 10,000, at 10,000 or over 10,000, DOT required. You know, especially if you're doing anything hauling, transporting materials, you need a DOT. Point blank, period, nothing around it. If you don't believe me, go look for yourself. Go on irs.gov or just Google it, Bing it, Yahoo it, whatever you want to do. Just look for it. my heavy haulers, my heavy hitters out here, you know, when you start moving up into these bigger trucks, you know, like I say, the one tons and you're hauling heavier trailers, my CDL guys, you already know this. Anything gross weighted, you know, if you have a truck, of course, that's over 26,001 pounds or more, you need a CDL. You know, especially if you're going to be hauling things that's going to be over, you know, 6 to 8 tons. If you're going to be hauling anything over that and you're going to have a trucker that, you know, that weight, and you're going to be able to pull, you know, tow things in gross combination over 20,000 pounds or more, you're going to need a Class A. Easily. You only need a Class B when you're doing 26,001 pounds and you're towing, you know, between 10,000 pounds or less, then you just need a Class B. But when you're towing more than 10,000 pounds and you have a vehicle that's gross weighted over 26,001 pounds, Class A all the way. Make sense? Now, let's not forget, you might not have a vehicle. You might be doing things of my nature, such as myself. I don't have a vehicle with air brakes and air over hydraulics, and my vehicles don't weigh over 26,000, you know, pounds in that nature. But I have my DOT for my one ton and my 2,500. Now, I can get away with towing all of my trailers with my 2,500 due to the fact that that GVW is at 10K. And all my other heavy trailers, such as my roll-off trailers, and dump the Max D and all that, that's gross weight of 14K. So if you do the 10 and the 14, where are we at? 24,000. Just those two things by itself. And even if you add me and the weight and things of that, you know, even if you add me and like some passengers and stuff, I meant to say, we're still not over that 26,000 and at that 1 pound yet. So I'm technically, even though I have my CDL, with my setup, you don't need it. You get what I'm saying? We're under 26,001. So if you have 2,500s, 350s, and they're gross weighted at 310, single axles, not dualies, they're gross weighted under 10. Excuse me, wrong. Lord, confuse myself. You at 10, and you're not over 14K as far as your gross weight with whatever you're towing, you're good. When you start up to 16, 18 plus, you need a CDL well off. Because they consider the gross weight of what the actual truck is and what it can tow or haul. And then they're considering the gross weight of the trailer itself, whatever the trailer weighs, and what it can actually physically hold on it, you know, towing and hauling or whatnot. So, like I say, when we hook up to a one ton, anything dual wheel, and it's GVW's gross, you know, weight, gross vehicle weight is at 14K. And then you got another 14K trailer. Where are you at now? 28,000 pounds GVCW or GC, you know, W or whatever. Gross combination weight rating. So by law, you need a CDL then. Even if the vehicle's not, you get what I'm saying? So it all plays out one way or another. So if you guys are doing any of that right now and you don't, you're running a risky business. And if you continue to still move like that, you're just getting by and you're lucky because you haven't been pulled over yet. And I wouldn't want that to happen to nobody. So like I say too, it all goes back to just not only having, we already covered the DOT, the CDLs, LLCs now. Shit, that's another beautiful thing, being a limited liability company. Me and myself still need to do that. I'm still a sole proprietor at the moment, but I am getting ready to get my LLC coming into this next year. And let me just give you guys a little brief overview of why you would probably need one instead of just either being like an S Corp or what is the other one? S or RP, whatever one I'm. And or just being a sole proprietor or whatever the other variants of you running a business could be. A limited liability company, LLC, in so many words, basically just separates you, yourself, from the entity of your business. So no one for any reason, if something ever happened and someone opted, they wanted to decide to try to sue you, they can't personally come after you. You the person and your personal assets. They can only sue the business and the business itself. It separates, in other words, without it being confusing, the LLC just basically protects you and your personal assets from your business. And in so many words, that's what it is. Now, of course, they have different ones where you could go up in pricing and, you know, you could up, I think the lowest is like 150 and the highest could go anywhere from like 1,000 and up, you know. Pretty sure over $1,000, however much money you want to invest into your LLC. And, you know, the more coverage and stuff goes up with, the more money you spend. You know how that stuff works. It's like regular insurance. So that's a good reason why you might want to consider having your LLC and converting over from a sole proprietor or, you know, S-corporate, like I said, the other ones that people might do. That's something to consider, too. Like I say, knowing, this goes back to weight and knowing weight distribution and stuff. Knowing your proper weight when hauling loads. I can't begin to tell you how many times I just see on the regular roads around here where I'm at. And I'm pretty sure it's the same thing wherever state you're in or city or county, wherever you're at in the United States or whatnot. People are overloading their trailers. Or you see the axle starting to bow out. You know, the tires are sagging or they don't have the right amount of air pressure in their tires and they're just dogging. They're dogging the trailer out and they're overusing it for what it's meant. Not only is that dangerous, it puts other people in harm's way. You're beating the hell out of the trailer. You're tearing it up, you know, putting more stress on the brakes, stopping power. You know, you're probably wearing the treads unevenly, messing that up, messing your tires up. You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's just so many things that come into factor. Your axle is the main thing. Your axle is what you need. You know, so once you blow those out and those go, you're talking money now. Who wants to replace the axle if you don't have to? So, guys, if you're going to do this right, know what your trailer can hold. It's okay with building size up, but still, you don't put a dual axle load on a single axle trailer and call yourself hauling, and in reality, you're just making it unsafe for others on the road, and you're just messing your equipment up. If you want to haul heavier loads, if you want to haul bigger loads, buy the right equipment. Enough said. All right. Do what you can do within your means right now. And don't have police or DOT on your back. You don't need those type of problems. You know, 9 times out of 10, they're going to check the guys who are legit. They're going to check the rigs. You know, it's crazy, right? These guys I'm just mentioning that do the shit all ass backwards, they get away scot-free and never get caught. But then guys like me and you who's doing the stuff right, people just want to pull you over just to check you, just to make sure you know. That hasn't really happened, but, it, from what I hear with the hot shot and you know, people going around, they dog those guys out a lot more than they do just the regular CDL drivers and stuff. With that being said, it's mainly because a lot of people that also get into the hot shotting game, they don't do the setups right. And they don't go about doing the proper things and learning the business before getting into it. And that's why, perfect example what I'm getting ready to get into next. If you don't have your CD already, you should get it. Because come February 7th of 2022, the FMCSA, and if you want to know what that abbreviation is, it's the Federal Motor Safety Carrier Administration. And basically, what they do, they're just monitoring all businesses, all trucks, and enforcing, you know, the DOT regulations, making sure mandatory drug testing is going on. They're tracking companies log and truck miles and their daily come, where they're going, whereabouts, and where they're stopping. And they deal with all of that stuff and mainly just making sure it's safe on the road for all people who's hauling and towing and things of that nature. But with the getting ready to crack down on now is getting your CDL. And what I mean by that is you will have to actually go to an actual trucking school to obtain your CDL after February 7, 2022. You can't do it through a local job or a local government agency. You can't you know, just learn from a buddy or a friend, and then you just go down like a month or two later and go to test for it. They letting you use their dump truck or something. Like, it's no. They're going to actually send you or make you go to school, a trucking school that's going to cost a couple $1,000s. But see how they're going to get you? Here's the flip side. The school will put you through school and, you know, pay for you to get your CDL. And if you pass, cool. But the flip side is either A, you're going to have to be on contract with that job for a certain duration of time, maybe a minimum of 2 years or more, and you're going to have to pay back half. Yes, correct. You're not going to pay for everything. You are going to have to pay back half of whatever that trucking school is. So if the trucking school is $5,000 altogether, you're paying $2,500 of that, and you have to be on contract with them for 2 years working with them. If for any reason, here's the flip side of it. Let's say you say, okay, who, F you, I don't want to work with this company, I don't like it. Bam, you already got your CDL now, right? Cool. Yeah, they pay for it, but you're liable for paying back the full debt now. And you still gotta go, you know, get another job and whatnot. So, you know, it's always a catch with everything. You know, if you're cool with that, hey. But if you have time, you know, anybody that's considering going to get it before then, February 7, 2022 is going to be a game changer. So, guys, I strongly advise you go ahead and do that so you don't have to go to an expensive trucking school and work with a company you might not want to work with. Okay, so touched on the weight regulations, the DOT, the CDL, the FMSEA, you know, knowing your proper load limits and stuff with trailers go haul, you know, if you're, I've touched on all that pretty much so far in the video. So, yeah, you guys, that's just a lot of reasons why, you know, you want to consider going legit in business either way. Also, just your goals and essence. I mean, you might be starting off small here and just be trying to gain a certain amount of residential clients, but let's say you want to start branching off and owning. You might want to have so many trailers or by this year. You might want to buy another dump trailer by next year. You might want to buy a dump truck or a truck with a dump body on it, you know, to carry around your crew members and whatnot with you, you know. So those could just be short-term goals you're working towards every day, you know, while becoming a legit business. And if you're heavy, whether you're still doing junk or water dumpster rental side of business, you could be working towards every day, as you might only have one bin right now. As to your short-term goal is from 6 to 12 months later, you would like to have five. And well, five could go from 5 to 10. You see what I'm saying? It's just setting specific goals for yourself within your business and knowing what it is and, you know, accomplishing them goals. That's the main thing. You don't want to stay stagnant. You don't want to stay in the same place. At least that's not what I'm doing. You guys see what I'm doing. So you couldn't have told me 4.5 years ago when I started this, I would have had, well, I've been where I would be at. And I'm not saying I ever doubted myself. It's just I didn't picture how big I was going to get into this until I actually started doing it. And I seen it was a passion of mine. The main thing is, for you to be legit, it has to be a passion behind it. You know, the money is going to come. The money is important because the money helps you grow. But you have to be passionate about your work. You have to take pride in your work. You have to love what you do. You have to have people around you that are content with what you do and they understand and are willing to help you get to where you need to go. And that's going to be touched on another subject. I'll do another segment later on discussing another issue, topic at hand or whatnot when it comes to junk removal. But, you know, of course, like I'm saying, all that plays a big, 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 big part in junk removal being legit, why you need to go legit, you know. It's just longevity of your business lasting. You know, you could have the best work ethic. You could know how to do it. You can know how to have all the tools. You can know how to, you could be the number one guy in the area. But if you're still doing things under the table, you will never potentially get to where you need to go. Because you're always taking shortcuts. You're always trying to, you know, not pay this person. Or you don't want to really bring on help because you're trying to do everything yourself. And you're tacking on jobs that you physically just can't do. And, you know, you're killing yourself in the process, or you're taking on jobs that you just don't have enough help or the manpower equipment to tackle. You know, a job that you probably could have finished within 3 hours with 3 to 4 people there, with 2 different trailers there, but it's just you, you're one person, and you only have like a little 6x10 or 6x12 trailer with some sides you built on, maybe only 1.5 sides. And now that job's taking you almost all day to 8 hours, and really the money you made, you kind of wasted time and assets, because you could have had other jobs coming in, or you could have went to other, maybe another 2-3 jobs before the day ended, but yet you was at this one job for 8 hours by yourself, killing yourself, when all you could have did, when you know, like, considered, and you're, you know, this is what I mean by when I say pricing jobs, right? Because you could have considered in your bed, okay, I want to get 2 people to help me with this job so I can knock this out quick, fast, pay my guys for 2 hours worth of work, boom, bam, done. And you still walk away with a good profit at the end of the day. So that's just another valid point. Considering, you know, bidding right on jobs and considering and knowing when you need help, when you should bring in an extra set of hands to make the jobs go by faster and easier. And certain things, when you can tackle it by yourself, then do it. But that's just a non-given. That's just a non-given, you know. So, yeah. Really, the whole purpose of this episode was just to let you guys know, going legit is not a bad thing. Being licensed and bonded is not a bad thing. It just protects you. It protects your business. It protects your business assets. It protects you as a person. It just makes you sleep better at night, knowing you have commercially insured vehicles, all of that, you know, and regular driver's insurance and things of that nature. Because, you know, let's say an accident occurs and you have your business plastered all over it. Insurance justice sees this. They drop you. Why? Well, you're not just out here driving like a normal civilian, and you're still under the influence. You know, they're still under the impression that you just have, let's say you have a pickup truck, dude, and they're just still under the impression that you're just driving this, you know, for your own use or just back and forth to work. But they had no idea where you were running a business, your regular car insurance or whoever you're going through. So therefore, they might not cover it, because they're going to say, well, you didn't have commercial insurance. Now you're screwed, or you're coming out of pocket, lost some money to get your own vehicle fixed, and possibly somebody else's vehicle, depending if you were at fault or not. You see what I'm saying? So all these things, all the little things that you think don't matter, they really do matter. It's costly, but as you grow, like I said, whoever's doing this, whoever's watching, you might not be there just yet. It's okay. I wasn't there a couple years ago. I wasn't there. I didn't have everything in order. I learned this stuff as time went on. I learned this stuff as I grew. And I just had to make a decision and say, hey, I need to get all my ducks in order. I need to have all my eggs, you know, in a batch lined up, so I know for a fact I'm good in all aspects and I'm well-rounded. I'm covered. If something should happen, I'm good. I'm covered. You could sleep well at night. At least I can. Well, don't you? So, you know, it's just the way to go. You know, another reason why I personally wouldn't want to do everything under the table, just for the simple fact, when you want to go writing off stuff, or just, you know, if you're getting everything in cash, cash is kind of hard to trace. Can't really trace cash unless you may doing everything with a receipt. And, you know, if you're doing everything on a receipt, wise with cash, and I guess you would have some form of paper trail for it, but cash is untraceable. As to where, when you're getting payments through an e-payment source, or whether you're doing credit or debit, you know, payments, or whether it might be something like Cash App, PayPal, Venmo, Apple Pay, Zelle, things of that nature, and things like that, then, hey, you're doing good for yourself, because that electronic trail, that could be tracked. And not only could those payments be tracked, but you also want to write that stuff off within a year. Look what we're getting into now. Income and expenses. Income and expenses. Of course you're going to want to report your income to the IRS. You should. You should. You know, showing that you're a good standing business and that, you know, they can actually see the type of money you're bringing in, and you know, all that stuff plays in a big part. Expense-wise, you should want to write it off, because you want to try to get some money back. if you spend out expense-wise anywhere from 20 to 50K in your business and you don't write it off, that's just 20, 50K you spent and it's not going for nothing. It's not going for nothing. And you're not getting nothing back on your investment or whatever you might have spent out. And, you know, that's crazy to me. You should want to get something back out of your expenses or whoever you spent money on or your contractors or whatever it may be. You see what I'm saying? Like, that's another thing. I'm not going to touch on it too much, but I don't have employees right now. I have independent contractors. It works better for how my business is set. The way I'm scaled right now, still being a small business owner, independent contractor way is the route to go for me. I still have all my guys on contract. I still pay my guys once a week with a business check. I still have 1040s on my guys. I get them to give that to them at the end of the, each year before, you know, December 31st. And they all file their taxes because I file my taxes and I let them know. And they get, you know, things saying that they need to file their taxes for the year. And themselves are responsible for making sure that happens. Once I cover my ass, I'm good. And I have a paper trail and record showing that I've been paying these guys, proof that I've been paying these guys all of this stuff throughout a year's time, and that they are actually an expense for my business. So, you know, that's just another thing. Income and expenses. You wanna consider that when being legit. You know, not doing everything under the table. So, you guys, with that being said, I'm getting ready to come up and close this episode out. I hope this was very informative. I hope this is giving you guys a little more insight about why you might want to consider some of the things I spoke on tonight in this video. And really just look forward to growing. And if you don't have any short-term goals or a business plan, really consider getting one together. It'll change your life. It'll change your life for the good. It'll change your life for the good. If you don't believe me, there's plenty of other guys on YouTube that's talking about these type of things. I'm just sharing my viewpoints and my point of view on how I look at how a successful business should run and things that it takes to be a legit business or a legit business owner. Male or female, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. So with that being said, guys, I hope you enjoyed the video. Continue to like, comment, share, subscribe. Hit that post notification button if you haven't. Hit that little bell. And we out. Your boy, with love.
Hey. Hey man, say man, y'all ain't know who it is. Pull up like money, get money. We ain't never slumming. On God.